city ring, and then the so-called the cilia, the ellipsoid, the inner segment, outer segment junction, as highlighted here. Pointer. So this is the cilia of the ellipsoid, inner segment, outer segment junction, correspond to this high density ring. So this is the highlight to you. This is the inner segment, outer segment junction, or the other name is ellipsoid or the inner segment, as shown here. So this correspond to I will show to you this edit where the action occurs. As the ring gets smaller, this ellipsoid inner segment junction would get smaller. The disease progress, this would get smaller. So this is a pretty important area I'd like to highlight. So in the presence of high psychic GMP with the phosphodiesterase not working, then we look at mice actually before the onset of before endosomal degeneration. And on a screen, I do not have time to tell you how we did the screen. I'll show you components of the mammalian target of rapamycin pathway seem to be activated before the onset of degeneration. So this is a control mouse, and this is a phosphodiesterase mutant mouse. At this age, by electron microscopy, the outer segment looks pretty normal. And this is a phospho-specific antibody to the mTOR component pathway. And this is in a normal mouse. You do not see the activation of the mTOR pathway. These are a phospho-specific antibody. And so these are the a control mouse, and this is the phosphodiesterase mutant mouse in the in the lower panel. So we thought, what about if we try to target this mTOR pathway? If you ablate the component of the mTOR pathway, try to activate, super activate the mTOR pathway, you can see improvement of the photoreceptor cells, and this is the control eye, and this is one to try to artificially activate the mTOR pathway using gene therapy. Again, if you activate the control single raw nuclei, you artificially activate the mTOR pathway, you get more cell survival. This is just some addition picture. So I show you that we have developed a new mouse model that now we can allow to assess the different stages and different threshold of how many, try to determine how many rods that we need to save in order to prevent the stage of no returns in the cones of getting these funny looking shaped cones. And then in most of our patients, because they're already in the mid or late stage of disease when they first come to clinic, so in addition to putting the gene, I think for these patients, we may need to use additional combination therapy, maybe involved in manipulation of the mTOR cell survival pathway, which I tried to show you. So I thank the Hope for Vision for the opportunity to come and also to support some of the initial work. And these are various people in the lab that has helped.
Great. Well, it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks again to Hope for Vision for having me. And it's wonderful to see so many great scientists here on behalf of the Board of Visionary Scientists. It's a really great thing to have everyone here, and so welcome, and it's a pleasure to talk about some of our work. I work for a small biotechnology company called Avalanche Biotechnologies, and what I thought might be interesting for the group to hear is a little bit about our experience in the clinic with gene therapy for wet age-related macular degeneration, and specifically some of the learnings, you know, we've had from taking a project that originated as an academic project into the clinical setting. And so the product's called AVA-101. It's a gene therapy product, AAV product, that provides long-term anti-VEGF delivery following a single injection. I'll talk a little about the clinical trial data in the phase one, you know, basically that's a safety study, but we are also looking for signs of biological activity. And the premise here is that new technology is needed for long-term delivery of anti-VEGF. And what you can see here is that patients who, let's see if I can find this. So patients who have macular degeneration lose about 15 letters of vision on average over a two-year period, but with monthly anti-VEGF therapy, in this case Lucentis, gain vision back and maintain that gain. If you try to spread out these injections to every, in this case, 3 months, you lose the benefit of that gain. And so what that's created in the vitreoretinal community is just a really an explosion in terms of the number of intravitreal procedures. This was a procedure that was virtually unknown in the year 2000, and now there are, you know, upwards of 2 million procedures per year, intravitreal injection for wet AMD, just the United States, just Medicare, and that's growing at about 30% per year. And so the technology is, you know, we've heard a lot about gene therapy. Basically, there's the concept is DNA encoding an anti-VEGF protein encapsulated in AAV serotype 2, and it's we call it the ocular biofactory. So it's injected subretinally and continues to create fresh therapeutic protein over time. And so the idea is that as opposed to the peak and trough pharmacokinetics that you have with injected intravitreal proteins, you have steady state pharmacokinetics following a single injection. So the gene that's delivered is called soluble FLT. It's really the only known direct VEGF inhibitor. It's the soluble form of the endogenous VEGF receptor, number one, and specifically domain two binds with a very high affinity interaction with VEGF. And this is the same domain and the same mechanism of action as the approved drug Eylea, which is used for macular degeneration, and also some other efforts in gene therapy. Notably, this is the Genzyme molecule here, SFLT01, all share this common binding domain, but in our case, we use the naturally occurring form of the full-length receptor. And so you'll see in this animation briefly how the drug is administered. It's a three-port pars plana procedure, and if you sort of zoom into the molecular level, it's being caused by VEGF receptor pathology causing that neovascularization. It's injected in about 100 microliter volume in the central retina, but not overlapping the fovea, creates soluble FLT, which binds and inactivates VEGF and prevents signaling through the VEGF receptor. And so you can see here the procedure as done in one of our clinical trial patients. You know, subretinal injection, I think there's a lot of confusion or misunderstanding in the community around how difficult it is or is not to do this, and is this a sort of commercially viable procedure? And in our experience, and I know there are folks in this room who have been involved in clinical trials, so I'll restrict my comments to just the AMD case in the elderly patients, that, you know, it's a fairly straightforward procedure where a bleb can be introduced reliably, takes, you know, a vitreoretinal surgeon a couple of tries to really understand the procedure because it's not currently performed commonly, but after that is fairly facile. And so this can be done under local anesthesia, and it's delivered using a commercially available biocompatible cannula. And so, you know, people ask us, why is subretinal injection, you know, why do we use subretinal injection for these vectors? And, you know, notably, there are other people using intravitreal injections. And so, you know, we point out that it's really a question of how strong the expression is subretinally compared to intravitreally. And also, you know, we tend to see less inflammation when these vectors are introduced subretinally. This is published paper on AVA-101 in primates, basically prevented choroidal neovascularization using laser-induced CNV 17 months following a single injection. And while there was elevation in the retina, there was no elevation in the systemic of this secreted protein. And so I'll just point you to two articles. We did a lot of extensive work. This is through our academic colleagues in Australia around the immunology of subretinal AAV2, SFLT, both in mice and then more recently in primates. So the clinical study is designed in three steps for a total of 48 patients. In step one, 1E10 vector genomes is given, and one patient got, as a control, ranibizumab, that's Lucentis, which is a commercially available drug, alone. In step two, it was a higher dose of 1E11 vector genomes versus ranibizumab alone. And in step three, 40 patients are randomized 2-to-1 between the high dose of the drug and ranibizumab alone. And so basically, because it takes some time for the AAV to express the protein robustly, patients are given standard of care ranibizumab on day 0 and day 30. By the time they come back for day 60, you take away the Lucentis and ask whether the secreted protein can effectively, you know, limit vision loss and limit neovascularization without the presence of rescue therapy. And so we have very specific ranibizumab retreatment, and there's a lot of clinical experience based on when anti-VEGF therapy can be given on an as-needed basis. And so our study, you know, borrowed heavily from that previous experience. So This is, again, a randomized controlled phase one study. The key inclusion criteria were subfoveal choroidal revascularization secondary to AMD, and patients had to have no previous retinal treatment of PDT or laser, but there was no limit to the number of previous anti-VEGF injections. So a lot of the patients we enrolled had long-standing and extensively treated macular degeneration. And essentially, it met its primary endpoint based on safety with no inflammation or retinal tears or detachment, no arterial thrombolic events, no clinically significant lab changes. Vector-specific safety, we did find biodistribution of the vector in the tears of the treated eye in 2 out of 6 patients, and there was no cytotoxic T-cell response noted. And what you can see here is the schedule of ranibizumab retreatments in the control patients versus the treated patients at either the low dose or the high dose. And patients in the control group were, as we would have expected, between 3 and 5 treatments per year on this rescue basis. And patients in the treated group had either no treatments required in the low dose, or in the case of the high dose, there was one patient that had one treatment at 90 days. And so just to walk you through a case, here's a patient coming into the study with 24 previous injections of Lucentis at screening and who had, you know, quite a bit of residual fluid, neovascular activity here, comes back at baseline, and this disappears and restores a generally normal retinal anatomy. And that's maintained in this patient through month 3, 4, all the way to month 10. This patient's now up to month 12 without any need for retreatment, and vision improved during that same period of 15 letters. So this is what we, you know, are really looking for, which is an improvement or a maintenance without the need for continued retreatment with an anti-VEGF therapy. Interim analysis of best-corrected visual acuity shows that control patients lost three letters during this period. It's very consistent with a lot of the, you know, previous studies of PRN therapy, whereas patients on the study drug gained, you know, between 9 and 10 letters. Again, this is early results based on phase one subjects, and the phase two is ongoing. So, you know, I thought what would be interesting for this group is to spend just a couple minutes talking about, you know, conclusions and some of the key learnings that we've had, again, translating work from an academic environment into a industry environment, into the clinic. So, you know, one of the first key learnings is that clinical grade manufacturing is extremely important. And, you know, it's hard to sort of overemphasize this point, particularly for an early stage project. I know transitioning myself from an academic environment into an industry environment was something that we didn't really emphasize from the perspective of an academic research project. Specifically, you know, which cell bank are you using? What's the origin of that cell bank? What are your assays to qualify your material, whether they're going into animals or whether it's, you know, supposed to ultimately be a GMP batch? How do you ensure the consistency from lot to lot? How do you characterize that material? And who are you using from a manufacturing perspective? Because once you get sort of set up with one CMO, it's quite difficult to switch. And so sort of nailing down those things early is a good idea. You know, the second thing is regulatory makes the rules. I think things that are, you know, dogma or that are found in references, they don't really count. It needs to be something that's in your hands. The product behaves in your hands, in your lab, with your assays, with your controls, the way that you expect it to behave. You know, and FDA and EMA guidance documents are you know, really there, they're published, they're easily available, and really enhance your understanding of how this works. Pre-IND interactions, so this is something the Office of Cell and Gene Therapy offers, which is an informal, you know, non-minuted meeting where you can go in and ask for feedback. And it can be useful, but not necessarily. I think it's important to ask, to be careful what you ask FDA, because you might just get the answer. So it's, in many cases, better to ask forgiveness than permission. If you just sort of walk in with, you know, hey, what should I do? They're going to give you the whole laundry list. Whereas if you say, you know, here's exactly what we plan to do and we think it's sufficient for X, Y, and Z reasons, that's a much better way to approach the regulatories. You know, and so how do you, you know, think a lot about making the research count. How do you sort of make the research that you do at an academic level or in a research level really count toward IND enabling studies so they don't have to be later repeated? And so, you know, there's a few things. You know, picking your cell bank or picking your manufacturing process early is certainly something that's helpful there, because if you switch, switching is starting over, right, in many ways. when you think about your construct, it's important to know and to be able to justify the origin of every single base pair for those of us working on gene therapy. Is there, you know, what elements are in there, what sort of remnant from cloning vectors from 20 years ago might be present, you know, in between your gene and your poly A tail? Do those need to be there? Can you, using modern day molecular biology techniques, make a better vector by eliminating them? And then intellectual property matters, right? So I think, you know, talking to academics, I've seen a lot of academics sort of mess this up. You know, when you disclose something, you know, choose your moment for when you disclose something, which should be obviously be after a patent filing. You know, make sure to protect ex-US rights in order to, you know, later be able to attract the investors who will be able to advance the project. That's actually quite critical to be able to have that intellectual property in hand. So just wanted to point folks to a few of these FDA and EMA guidance documents. It's not, you know, these aren't gospel, but it, you know, it is sort of like a decree from the Pope. Now that we have a new Pope, we can all think that's on the mind. And here's the URL. And, you know, I'll give a little plug for GMP manufacturing. We have a collaboration that we announced with Lonza last year. And the goal of this collaboration is, you know, not just for our products, but actually to make this available to the gene therapy community using our technology and making it available through Lonza, who's a commercial manufacturing provider. And so anyway, I could talk more about this, but this is an opportunity to have clinical grade GMP manufacturing that can sort of go the distance, not just through phase one, but can go through the distance through the commercial grade. So that's all with that. I'd just like to acknowledge collaborators at UNC, at Lions Eye Institute in Australia, and at Avalanche. Thanks.
Historically, retinitis pigmentosa has been known as a condition with no treatment, but beginning in the 1980s and 90s, new therapies were proposed, including retinal cell transplantation and also retinal prosthesis development. We were the developer of the artificial silicon retina, the first retinal prosthesis. I can probably just talk like that.
Okay.
We've been involved in a number of clinical studies. I'm here to report some of the long-term effects and the results in some of these patients. The artificial silicon retina is a 2 millimeter diameter chip, approximately 25 microns thick, and its surface are approximately 5,000 microphotodiodes. These microphotodiodes are miniature electronic components that take light and convert it into electric currents. When put into the subretinal space, they stimulate the overlying retinal cells, in this case, remnant photoreceptor and bipolar cells. In June of 2000, 2001, and 2002, phase one and phase two FDA-approved study was conducted involving initially 10 patients and eventually up to about 42 patients implanted in multiple centers across the United States. Okay, there we go. Make a 3 millimeter incision through the sclera, and then we bring the implant into the vitreous using a special insert that we do a fluid air exchange, and this is then put underneath the retina through a retinotomy, either with the inserter, or we could use a aspiration cannula. You can see it's a very straightforward procedure. And here we use this a irrigation cannula to put the implant through there. What we found was that in addition to the implant being well tolerated and producing phosphenes, we're seeing that there was a neurotrophic effect from the implant, and that patients were regaining vision in areas outside where the implant was. And this was a return of a central visual acuity, of color perception, of visual field size, and darkness perception. Here you can see the difference between the implant eye and the unimplanted eye. There was a huge increase in letter recognition immediately, then tapered off. Here's another patient, again, just a huge increase in the number of letters read compared to the unoperated eye. Yeah, we're really getting a problem with this. Okay, this patient was implanted, and I'll show you the difference between before surgery and after surgery.
Yes, but I cannot tell what it is.
Thank you, guys.
this was before surgery. His vision was about hand motions. And so we test him using the ETDRS chart, in this case, at about 1/2 meter.
No. Here. No. Here. No. Here. No. Here. No. 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 No.
This is now 1 month after surgery.
S R K N O K Z O H.
Dramatic responses where you went from hand motions to not being able to see the eye chart. And we saw this, these kind of improvements consistently in all 10 of the patients we first implanted. Let's get back over here again. All right. So we started investigating this effect, and we noted that we could also reproduce these effects in the animal models. This is the RCS rat, and here you can see in the implanted animal the preservation of the ERG B-wave activity compared to these two animals. One was a sham control, and one just had a minimally active implant. We also looked at the preservation of the endonuclear layer cells, and here you can see this is an animal that did not have the implant in. You can see the only, this is with the implant. You can see the preservation of the cells here, compared to this animal that did not have the implant. We also looked to see what was the mechanism, and we discovered that we were getting an upregulation specifically of FGF2. It's a neurotrophic factor. So you can see in this graph here, this is FGF2 from the eye of an implanted animal. This is in a control animal. This is from a sham operation where the operation was done but no implant was put in. And this is an animal where a minimally active implant was placed. So we've now had these implants into humans for between 7 and 8 years, and we find that the implants are well tolerated for at least 7 to 8 years, and the vision in the implanted eye is still improved compared to the eye before surgery, and also compared to the unimplanted eye. We integrated a new test called grading acuity. We found that with this new test, we could test to lower levels of vision, and we evaluated these patients continuously during this period. We found that the improvement persists. Here you can see this improvement initially. There's a slight drop-off because of the drop-off in the growth factors caused just by the surgery. But you can see the persistence of improvement even up to about 7 to 8 years compared to the unoperated eye, which dropped. This is the grading acuity in the log scale. You can see again the improved vision in the implanted eye versus the unimplanted eye. Here are two more patients, huge increase initially. We have some ideas of why there's some initial drop, and we're working on to try to mitigate that drop. On the grading acuity, you can see again, over a period of up to 7 to 8 years, the improved vision in the implanted eye compared to the unimplanted eye. Another patient, here you can see using leather testing, you couldn't really tell too much of a difference between the two eyes. But using the grading acuity, you can see over a period of many, many years, the improved vision in the implanted eye versus the unimplanted eye. One of the patients passed away at 5 years from a ruptured abdominal aneurysm. His eyes was donated, and we can see from these views that the implant is well tolerated. There's virtually no inflammation around the implant. We looked at the implant itself, and the implant was actually quite good preservation, minimal etching of the implant. and we still had very good electrical activity from this device. In fact, there was some even better activity compared to before implantation. What was remarkable is in the eye that had the implant, there was preservation of some structure of the retina, including cells, compared to the opposite eye, where there was marked disorganization. Here's another section. In the implanted eye, you can see the outer plexiform with some cells still present. In the opposite eye, you can see the marked thickened disorganization. So this is consistent with the neurotrophic rescue effect that we've seen. Our conclusions, ASR chips are well tolerated in RP patients for at least 7 to 8 years. All the ASR implanted eyes show improved visual acuity at the end of the study period compared to before surgery and compared to the unoperated eyes. This is the first report of a long-term therapeutic rescue of visual function in RP patients. A removed chip showed excellent functional activity and has probably a lifespan of about 20 years. Substantially better preservation of retinal cells and architecture was seen in the ASR implanted eye compared to the unimplanted eye. This is consistent with a neurotrophic rescue effect. We had spent about $50 million going through the phase one and phase two period. A final phase three was actually approved by the FDA, but the size of the study they wanted would have cost around $200 million, probably more. Unfortunately, there was no funding for this kind of study, and Aquabiotics unfortunately ceased operations. Fortunately, I was able to acquire the implants and the related scientific documents. We're now in the process of trying to raise funds for a humanitarian devices exemption study. Now, what I want to do is, you know, we see results on presentations, but this is what happens.
I'm a homemaker, and I work with vacuum cleaners and a lot of, you know, Pledge and Windex and cleaning tools and stuff. I noticed that the other day, I was actually, instead of walking across the room and feeling or using my feet to kick out and find that vacuum cleaner that I had misplaced, I actually was able to look across the white carpet and see that vacuum cleaner standing there. I was at for the first time in years, I was actually able to walk over to that vacuum cleaner and pick it up without fumbling.
How did that make you feel?
It was great. It was fabulous. I loved it.
So again, these are the real patient responses. Thank you.
So I'm really excited about all the work that we potentially have for the future with your work. And I'm going to talk about two technologies that actually have been done in Europe, in Tübingen, with Dr. Eberhard Schrenner. One is with the subretinal implant, which Alan has just talked about. This is a little different type of implant. And one is with transcorneal electrical stimulation in patients with retinitis pigmentosa. So first I'm going to just cover some of the things about a retinal implant, and as Dr. Alan has talked about, it's a device which will convert light into electrical impulse and then deliver this electrical impulse to the remaining retinal cells, which will then transmit this downstream to create a visual response. So over several years, many experiments have been done in Tübingen to develop a wireless subretinal implant. And it was determined that an implant under the posterior retina, in order to give a visual acuity of approximately 2200s, which would give recognition of details and the ability to read large letters, would need receptors of about 1,500 receptors. So they picked the development of a 1,500 receptor implant to be placed under the retina. And this is done through a surgical technique. Opening is made in the sclera. The retina is elevated by making a bleb, as you've seen earlier, and then sliding the implant back under the posterior pole. The implant is then connected to a magnetic receptor under the skin behind the ear, And I'll show you in a moment how energy is applied to that. This is a little mock-up video of how the implant is placed. It's placed under the retina here. The these are in completely blind patients with no light perception. The vision is, the light is transmitted through the normal ocular focusing mechanisms onto the implant, changing the light response to an electrical response, which is then transmitted to the adjacent cells, and then this response travels downstream through the optic nerve to create a visual response. The implant gets its power from a handheld device, which is battery operated, and it's held against the skin by a magnet, and there's a transdermal response which connects the power to the implant. You can see the cable that goes from the magnetic receptor under the skin, across the temple, and into the orbit where the implant is. Now, this is a patient, this is one of the first patients who received one of these implants. He's been blind with no light perception for about 15 years. I have several videos of different things that he's doing, but he's only been allowed to have this implant for 4 months because in the original trials, they had to remove the implants after they were placed to look if there was any damage, both either to the implant or to the retina. Now he's in Europe, there's a famous race car driver by the name of Mika, which happens to be this gentleman's name. He's wearing a pair of a trial frame. This is not a camera, he just has the right prescription for glasses.
But what's wrong with this
one?
One eye missing on the second eye and second K on the
side. Oh! Yeah.
And this is a young gentleman has an implant. He's been blind for about 10 years, no light perception, and this is his daughter, and he's recognized her features.
Er greift zielstrebig an die Nase.
Ans Kinn.
Und ans Kinn. Und dann hat er was entdeckt, was glitzert.
Kette.
Und dann zieht er Margot auch noch an den Ohr.
So these implants have been placed now in the past 5 years in close to about 30 patients. And so these are patients, again, like you've all been talking about, where the outer segments are gone, but there are still working cells. So these are transmitting an electrical impulse created by light to the remaining cells. So the remaining cells are still functioning pretty well. So these patients, most were able to perform visual tasks to see near, far, good hand-eye coordination, seeing moving objects, recognizing facial features and large letters, with the best visual acuity of about 2600. In two patients, the device stopped working. They had to take it out and put a new one in, and they were able to do that without any major damage. The only major adverse events, other than the fact that it stopped working, was the fact there was some corneal dehiscence in a couple patients.